This is a global original podcast from Classic FM.
Ah, the beautiful sound of the trumpet. Truly one of the world's most elegant instruments.
David, that's not a trumpet.
Ah, the beautiful sound of the bagpipes. Truly one of the world's most elegant instruments.
It's a piano.
I don't think it is. I mean, it says piano here, but I assume that was a typo. But fine, have it your way. Ah, the piano. Truly one of the world's most elegant instruments. Hi, I'm classical music expert David Williams, and today we're going to take a look at the piano and lay out its colourful history in black and white.
See, another typo. How can you have colour in black and white?
Because the keys are black and white.
This is nonsense, and I refuse to continue.
You won't get your biscuit.
I take everything back. Let's crack on. The piano is one of the most famous instruments in the world. It's known for beautiful pieces like Beethoven's Fur Elise, which we're listening to right now. And when you listen to something as iconic as this piece, it's hard to imagine that there was a time when the piano simply didn't exist. But for most of history, it didn't.
Morning, fellow 1600s peasant. What are you up to today?
Well, I'm not listening to the piano, that's for sure. It hasn't been invented yet.
Do you think it'll ever be invented?
Honestly, I don't care. I'm too busy being afraid of almost everything.
That does take up a lot of time. Well, see you tomorrow, if you live that long.
I doubt it.
Ta-ra!
Before the piano, there was the harpsichord, which you may recognise as that plinky-plonky instrument that lets you know you're in olden days. Oh boy, doesn't that just put you in the mood for a delicious royal feast and a lovely beheading? Instruments with keyboards had existed all the way back to the ancient Greeks, but the harpsichord was the king of the keys in the years before our old friend the piano came along. If you've never seen a harpsichord, it looks just like a piano, except it has a slightly shorter keyboard and no pedals. But the biggest difference between the two instruments is that when you press a key on the harpsichord, a string inside is plucked. Whereas on a piano, when you press a key, the string is hit with a little hammer, presumably wielded by a tiny troll. That's right, folks. A piano is made out of lots of tiny hammers. It's the Bob the Builder of instruments. Now, unfortunately, we can't have Bob the Builder on the show for legal reasons, so instead, here's his copyright-free equivalent, Conrad the Constructor.
Can we construct things?
It seems likely.
So, Conrad, it turns out that pianos are filled with tiny hammers.
That's right, old man. Inside the main part of a piano, there are over 200 strings, all stretched tight. When you hit one of the 88 keys on a piano, it moves a little seesaw, which has a hammer at the end of it. This hammer then strikes a string and makes the sound.
What stops the hammer from breaking the string?
Well, the strings are made of steel and the hammers are made of wood and felt. So, it's no contest, really.
And this is definitely a piano and not a trumpet or bagpipes?
Correct. You're clearly a very clever man.
Great. Thought so. Just checking. So, it's the late 1600s, and everyone's harpsichording around, having a good time, but not a great time. You see, the harpsichord can be hard to play, and it doesn't have any dynamics, which is a fancy way of saying you can't play it quietly or loudly. It always just stays the same volume. This meant that composers began to feel limited by the instrument. I mean, how are you supposed to write a soft, tender piece of music if your instrument can't be soft and tender? It simply can't be done! Sorry, got a bit worked up there. After the reign of the harpsichord, it was time for someone to create a brand new and completely different instrument. OK. Not completely different, but Around the year 1700, the piano was invented by an Italian called Bartolomeo Cristofori.
Hey, call me Bart.
Great to have you on the show. So, Bart, how exactly did you invent the piano?
Well, I was walking down the street one day, and I thought to myself, why isn't there a musical instrument that looks like a zebra? So I made one. The piano. The end.
Oh. Are you sure there wasn't more to it than that?
You know, my memory is not so great these days, but I am pretty sure that's how it went down.
Right, because it says here in my notes that you were actually hired by an Italian prince to create a new instrument and you spent years carefully creating the piano.
You know, now you mention it, that actually sounds much more likely.
Yes, that's because it's true. Well, thank you for your time. You've been utterly useless.
You're welcome.
One of the first ever descriptions of a piano comes from the year 1700. It says,
un arpicembalo di Bartolomeo Cristofori, di nuova invenzione, che fa il piano e il forte.
Let me translate that for you on the fly and not in any way read it off this piece of paper I have in front of me. An arpicembalo by Bartolomeo Cristofori, a new invention that produces soft and loud sounds. Translation ends. Oh. Sorry, wasn't meant to read that last bit. Arpicembalo was probably what the instrument was called at the time. I'm sure you'll agree, it's an absolutely terrible name. I mean, you thought Conrad the Constructor was clunky, and then Arpicembalo comes along and blows it out of the water. The name piano actually comes from the Italian sentence we just heard.
Che fa il piano e il forte.
This sentence states that the instrument can be played both softly, which in Italian is the word piano, or loudly, which in Italian is the word forte. So, over time, this description of the instrument
che fa il piano e il forte
got shortened down until the name was simply
piano.
I personally would have named it the Thunderbox 2000, but that's just me. This magical new invention was beloved by composers because of its great range of musical capabilities. Piano music can be soft and gentle, like in Chopin's Nocturne in E-flat major. It can be fiery and energetic, like in Beethoven's Piano Concerto No. 5. That piece has often been called the greatest ever written for the piano.
Oh, very kind of you to say, David.
You're welcome, Beethoven. Of course, an instrument is useless if you've got no one to play it. So let's take a look at some of the most famous people to ever smash the keys. First of all, there's the Music Man, who comes from down your way, and he can play.
What can he play?
He plays the piano. We've already been over this.
Pia, pia, piano, 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 pia, pia, piano.
No, none of that. Get out of here, all of you. Go on, scram! Sadly, the Music Man is a fake and a charlatan and only exists in that irritating song. Someone who arguably does exist, however, is Lang Lang, a Chinese virtuoso pianist. When he was only 2 years old, Lang Lang watched a Tom and Jerry cartoon episode called The Cat Concerto, which featured Franz Liszt's Hungarian Rhapsody No. 2. Lang Lang heard that music and developed an instant fascination with the piano.
I don't blame that baby. That's one of the finest piano pieces ever written.
Right, Franz Liszt. And you're not just saying that because you wrote it, are you?
Did I write it? I didn't even know that. I just heard an incredible piece of music and had to compliment it.
Really?
Yep, I mean, I have to be honest. It sounds like whoever wrote it was incredibly handsome. Whoever it was. But I don't know who it was.
Ignoring you now. Lang Lang started piano lessons at the age of 3 and had won his first competition at the age of 5. He is now one of the most popular pianists in the world.
I'm still here.
And I'm still ignoring you. Lang Lang has performed in front of the Pope, at the opening ceremony of the Beijing Olympics, and at the White House for President Obama. Although not all at the same time. But I bet he could! Here he is, playing one of the most beautiful pieces ever written for the piano. Beethoven's Appassionata Sonata. Delightful. Doesn't the sound of that piece just make you want to reunite with a long-lost pet in a tear-jerking slow-motion montage? No? Just me? Okay, fine. Lang Lang may be a modern marvel, but probably the most famous classical pianist of all time is Rachmaninoff.
Hello, David. Who's that guy sulking in the corner over there?
That's Franz Liszt. We're ignoring him. One of the reasons Rachmaninoff gained such an incredible reputation is that he had famously massive hands, and this meant he could comfortably stretch his fingers huge distances around the piano keyboard. Here is one of his own pieces, the impressively speedy Piano Concerto No. 2. What's it like having such massive hands?
Well, on the one hand, gloves don't fit. And on the other hand, they don't fit either. Because both hands are equally massive. I'm terrible at Jenga and sending WhatsApps, but I can play the piano like a true master. So it's not all bad.
Well, you are a genuine piano legend. So for that, I want to give you a big hand. Never mind. Don't sit in the corner with Liszt. Marta Argerich is an Argentinian pianist who is also hailed as one of the greatest pianists who's ever lived. You see, we only have the very best people on this show. And me. Marta Argerich is 75 years old and she still plays piano like she's only 74. Take a listen to Marta in action. The piano has allowed musicians to play with music in new and inventive ways, and even create whole new genres. Duke Ellington and Thelonious Monk are two musicians who took their knowledge of classical piano and used it to help create a brand new genre called Jumanji. Jazz. Jumanji is a film that I didn't get cast in. It seems to be a lot of those. Smooth stuff from Thelonious Monk. Fun fact, his real name is Thelonious Sphere Monk, which is possibly even better. It's not just jazz musicians who love the piano, film composers adore it too. The piano has been used to create some of the most iconic sounds in the world of entertainment. Here, see if you can guess which films these piano pieces are from, just based on their first few notes. Of course, that's Let It Go from Frozen. I'm not in that one. Now, try this. That's City of Stars from La La Land. Bit more of a grown-up one, that. And yet another film I'm not in. Now, try this last one. That's right. That's Things Are Getting Better. Bee Bar Bow from Pudsey the Dog the Movie, which I was actually in. Nothing to do with the piano, but probably one of your favourite films, right? Right? I knew it. So, there we have it, listener friends. You now know everything there is to know about the piano. The next time you see a cartoon character about to drop a piano on someone, you'll step in and say, "Now, hold on. That's not just some heavy object with which to squash your nemesis flat. That's a beautiful instrument with a storied past." And then maybe you could spend about 40 minutes explaining to them in intricate detail the precise history of the piano. Or not. Your choice. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to go and record a guest appearance on Conrad the Constructor. So, to play us out, here's Beethoven's Emperor Concerto.
Recordings in today's episode were used courtesy of Harmonia Mundi, Classic FM, Warner Classics, Sony Music Legacy Recordings, and Vertigo Films. You can find out more about all the wonderful pieces you heard at classicfm.com. David Walliams' marvellous musical podcast was written by Benedict Townsend, with further material by the Dawson Brothers. Additional characters were voiced by Ruth Bratt, Mike Wozniak, Nadia Carmel, Colin Holt, Cariad Lloyd, and Guy Harris. We hope you enjoyed this episode. Next time, we'll find out how Ethel Smythe shattered expectations to become one of the first female composers and got thrown into prison as a result.
Well, thank you for your time. You've been utterly useless.